Assalamu alaikum everyone, hope you guys are fine, doing well. This is me, Dr. Shadab, and we are today beginning brachial plexus injuries. Okay, hope you guys are preparing well for your exam. Okay people, so this is today's topic on brachial plexus injury. In the previous lecture, we studied the sensory supply of upper limb, complete sensory supply, arm, forearm, and hand also. And I told you the important points regarding it. So today's lecture will be based on entirely on brachial plexus injuries. Now, you know, studying brachial plexus injury is very interesting, because it is a clinical presentation, and also when you will be studying it along with me, you will notice that everything you have studied, you just have to merge your concepts and apply to it. Okay, so let's begin. Now you see, when I was teaching you the brachial plexus. Okay people, I was kind of searching this picture. Okay, when I was teaching you brachial plexus earlier, I told you that we studied brachial plexus with like roots, trunks, divisions, cords, and branches, right? So now when we will be studying injuries, we will be studying the specific injuries related to the five main brachial nerves, that is musculocutaneous, axillary, median, radial, and ulnar. You will see when these nerves are damaged, what presentation the patient comes to you. Okay. And also, we will study upper trunk and lower trunk injuries. Getting my point? We will study upper trunk injury and we will study lower trunk injury. So today, we will study upper trunk injury and lower trunk injury. Got it? Now, you see, the C5 and C6 cervical nerves unite together and form upper trunk. Okay, and we have also seen that one nerve arises from C5, one nerve arises from C5, C6, C7, and there are two nerves that arise from upper trunk. If you remember this whole concept that I told you, it will be easy. Now, if you have kind of forgotten it, let me show you. It was lecture number 7. Yes, this was the picture. It was lecture number 7. Let me zoom it a bit for you. Okay, now it is you people can open all these things like this, because everything is updated on my blog page, which is under anatomy. When you will go to PMDC anatomy and click it, then you will just scroll it down and you will see all this stuff from lecture number 1 to lecture number 8. I have updated with all the YouTube links also, and all and the notes, the MCQs, the images. Okay, I've used a PPT in lecture number 5. I've updated that also. And lecture number 6, brachial plexus image, this image. And lecture number 7, brachial plexus image, this one. Okay. Also, I made a PDF image on sensory supply of forearm, arm, and hand. So you can have that also. I guess I have saved it. So I may show you. This one. Of sensory supply of arm and forearm. You see, I've written the MCQs over here. I've made sterics, so you can download these two pictures also from there. So in this way, you can like have all the stuff which I used. And after the completion of brachial plexus injuries, we will have the complete MCQ session on the upper limb. So I will upload that PowerPoint also, link also over here. So all these things have been uploaded and updated over here, and you guys can just grab it with one click. Okay, just as I have clicked this image, the pink ones are the links. I've clicked image and then the image is opened over here. You can also download the image, or if you cannot download the image, then tell me. There might be some privacy restriction. I will change it. Okay, I've cross-checked everything. And also, you guys can go back to your Google Drive and check the recent folders. There you can find everything which you clicked. Okay, so that has once been opened. Okay, so this is how. Now we will continue our lecture today on brachial plexus injury, on the upper trunk injury, C5, C6 upper trunk injury. I've opened this picture so that you may also see that the first nerve that was arising from C5, I taught you, was dorsal scapular nerve, okay? And it was innervating three set of muscles, okay? The rhomboids and the levator scapulae. The rhomboid major, rhomboid minor, and levator scapulae, okay? If you have listened this lecture number 7, you might have learned it by now. And the number 2 nerve is that is made by the combination of C5, C6, C7. Okay, this nerve is called long thoracic nerve, and it innervates the muscle serratus anterior. Okay, and then this, there are two nerves that arise from upper trunk. This is the upper trunk. Okay, the third and the fourth nerve. So the third nerve is suprascapular nerve. Suprascapular nerve innervates two muscles, supraspinatus and infraspinatus. And then the fourth nerve, which is called subclavian nerve, innervates the muscle subclavius. I guess till here you guys are clear. Now, when we move a bit further, there is no nerves from the divisions, okay? And then we have this lateral cord. This lateral cord from which nerve number 5 arises, which is lateral pectoral nerve, okay? And lateral pectoral nerve innervates pectoralis major muscle, okay? Pectoralis major and pectoralis minor. ठीक है, यहाँ पर नीचे भी लिखा हुआ है pectoralis major muscle, lateral pectoral nerve, medial pectoral nerve, major and minor muscles. ठीक है, so we are only talking about lateral pectoral nerve. And then you see musculocutaneous nerve is also a part of this upper trunk, because all these things are a part of upper trunk. Okay, and not only musculocutaneous, we see a division coming down. We see a division coming down, which is forming median also, So whenever we will encounter an upper trunk injury, the nerves which will be, there is a chance of the nerves that will be damaged will be these two nerves. Okay, we will not see the injuries to number 1 and number 2 because they're arising from the root. When we talk about upper trunk injury, C5, C6 injury, we see this injury at herbs point, and this is the herbs point. The point where six nerves unite is called herbs point. Now you count with me. This red line is number 1. This red line is number 2. They are two different nerves. C5 cervical nerve 5. C6 cervical nerve 6. So these two nerves are uniting at this point, then they are forming an upper trunk. And then you see this number 3 and number 4. It's just a diagram, but when you will see the original picture of brachial plexus, you will see that there are these 6 nerves. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, and then forming this musculocutaneous at the end. So this is called herbs point. Okay, so we will have the injury over here at this particular level. So the nerves which are present before this particular level will be fine. But when this pathway is cut, the nerves after this level will be damaged. So which nerves will be showing problems? Number 3, number 4, number 5, musculocutaneous, median, and also axillary. Why axillary? A bit of radial also, but majorly axillary. Why? Because you see, this upper trunk have two divisions, an anterior division and a posterior division. So this posterior division is contributing to form this posterior cord. Okay, and then this posterior cord is making axillary nerve, also radial nerve. So we will also see some problems with the axillary nerve damage as well. Okay, I guess till now I'm clear. Okay, let's move further. Let's go to the notes. Now you see this injury is called waiter tip deformity, or policeman tip or porter tip. And also known as Erb-Jukin palsy. Some people called it Jukin, some people called it Dutchney. Okay, whatever people are pronouncing, you must know that we are talking about C5 and C6 upper trunk injury. Okay, the name Erb-Jukin is after Erb. It's a name of someone who just told that this kind of injury, who was the first person to tell about this. So usually in medical we see most of the names after such people, and he also named that point Erb's point because he discovered that the details of this. So after his name it is Erb-Jukin palsy, also called as waiter tip, policeman tip, porter tip. Why it is these strips? Okay, I will show you. Okay, now come to the details. Now, as I've told you that this is a C5, C6 upper trunk injury, so I guess this point is clear. I told you we will see the problems with a number of nerves, including axillary nerve, musculocutaneous nerve. That from the five main branches, you have to remember axillary and musculocutaneous with C5, C6. Okay. And then also suprascapular nerve. Let's go back to the picture. Suprascapular nerve. You see nerve number 3, which is arising from the upper trunk. Nerve number 3, this is suprascapular nerve, and also subclavian nerve, it is arising from number 4. Number 4, okay? Now, I've only written the names of major nerves so that you may not find it more difficult. This is all which is important, and you need to remember with C5, C6 upper trunk injury, there is a damage to axillary nerve, musculocutaneous nerve, suprascapular nerve, subclavian nerve, okay, affected. Now, let's revise our previous lectures a bit for the ease. I told you there are two muscles which are innervated by axillary nerve, and one of the muscle is the deltoid. Okay, one of the muscle is the deltoid. So you will see deltoid paralysis because deltoid muscle is present on the shoulder. Okay, and it is coming towards the upper part of arm also. It is coming towards the upper part of arm also. If you remember this picture, not this one. If you remember this picture which I have drawn for you, I told you in this lecture that this is a deltoid muscle which is present on the shoulder, and it is coming to the upper part of arm also. And this deltoid muscle is innervated by axillary nerve. Okay, axillary nerve. So not only we see the motor supply of deltoid muscle by axillary nerve, but also axillary nerve has a sensory innervation to this muscle also. So both the motor and sensory innervations to deltoid muscle are provided by axillary nerve. Now, just apply some common sense that when axillary nerve is damaged, the deltoid muscle will be paralyzed. Okay, no motor function. What is the function of deltoid muscle? We have studied in lecture number 2. Okay, what is the function of deltoid muscle? It abducts the shoulder joint, and the angle is 15 to 90 degree. The initiation is done by supraspinatus, that is 0 to 15. Okay, and then after initiation, from 15 degrees to 90 degrees, it is done by deltoid muscle, which is innervated by axillary nerve. So we will see no abduction from 15 to 90 degrees. Clear? Because deltoid is paralyzed. Also, axillary nerve provides sensory innervation to this muscle. So the patient will have a regimental bath sign. If you remember when I was teaching you the second lecture, when I was teaching you muscles, I told you that there is a regimental bath sign, just like the army people who have a badge on the lower half of deltoid. So that is what we call regimental bath sign. Okay. So you will see a regimental bath sign. You will see a deltoid muscle paralysis, no abduction from 15 to 90 degrees. Clear. This is all because of axillary nerve. Okay. And now come to musculocutaneous nerve. What muscles musculocutaneous, whenever you think of a nerve injury, that this particular nerve is injured, okay, think about its muscles also to which it is innervating. Okay, that is how you correlate things in anatomy, and that is how anatomy becomes easy. People say anatomy is very difficult. It's all about mugging, but it is not about mugging. I never mugged anatomy. I understand it very conceptually, and then I appeared in my exam and I scored well. So this is how you can also do it. Now, if you talk about musculocutaneous nerve, which muscles musculocutaneous nerve innervates to? I told you a mnemonic regarding musculocutaneous nerve, BBC. If you remember, if you have listened my lecture number 2, you should know that there is a mnemonic BBC, that is bicep brachii brachialis and coraco brachialis. Again, I'm repeating, bicep brachii, brachialis and coraco brachialis, B, B and C. Okay, so these three set of muscles are flexors. They are present in the anterior compartment of arm. Remember, I told you we have two compartments of arm, an anterior and a posterior compartment. So the anterior compartment have three set of muscles, BBC, which are innervated by musculocutaneous nerve. So that means if musculocutaneous nerve is damaged, we will see a paralysis of biceps, brachialis and coracobrachialis. And the action to which these muscles are responsible, that is flexion, we will not see flexion. Okay. Regarding muscles, whenever a muscle is damaged and its function is flexion, for example, a muscle is damaged and its function is flexion, then after the damage of that muscle, what action you will see? The opposite one, right? When a muscle is all right, it is perfect, you are seeing flexion. Now apply it onto your hand. You have biceps brachii, brachialis and coracobrachialis on your anterior compartment of forearm, and you can flex it because your muscles are normal. There is no damage. But now just think for a while that the musculocutaneous nerve is damaged and you see a paralysis to these three set of muscles. Now you cannot flex your hand. Now your hand will be remain in the opposite to flexion. And what is the opposite to flexion? Extension. Now your hand will remain in an extended position. So thus you see musculocutaneous nerve injured, biceps brachii, the full name, I have only written biceps, okay, brachialis, and I have not mentioned coraco brachialis because it's a very small muscle. So the major flexion is done by these two muscles. Okay, so I have only written the name of two muscles, but there are three muscles which are responsible for flexion and are innervated by musculocutaneous nerve. Okay, now this nerve is damaged, these three set of muscles are paralyzed, and you cannot flex your arm, and the action now you will see in the patient with this type of injury will be extended hand. The patient will not be able to flex his elbow joint. The elbow joint will remain in an extended position. Clear? Same goes to deltoid. Deltoid was innervated by axillary nerve, and when deltoid is paralyzed, it cannot abduct the hand from 15 to 90 degrees. Therefore, the patient's hand will be adducted. So here is written adducted. Okay. Now come to suprascapular nerves. Now you see suprascapular nerve innervates two muscles, that is supraspinatus and infraspinatus. Okay. So whatever the function supraspinatus and infraspinatus responsible for, they are the rotator cuff muscles. Supraspinatus also abduct the hand. It is responsible for the initiation of abduction, that is from 0 to 15 degrees. Now, when the suprascapular nerve is damaged, you cannot initiate abduction as well. So now you see, the patient is not able to abduct his hand from 0 to 15 degrees because of supraspinatus and suprascapular nerve, and the patient is not able to abduct his hand from 15 to 90 degrees because of deltoid muscle damage to axillary nerve. So overall, the abduction is affected, and what you will see in the patient, the opposite to abduction. And what is the opposite to abduction? Adduction. Okay, so the hand will be adducted. Okay, now come to subclavian nerve. Subclavian nerve innervates subclavius muscle. So you will see the damage to subclavius also. Now if I'll show you a bit of the portions of the book which I have uploaded over here. Now you see, this is the subclavius muscle innervated by subclavian nerve. Nerve to subclavius from the upper trunk of brachial plexus. Okay, and what is the action? Depresses the clavicle and steadies this bone during movements of the shoulder girdle. So it depresses the clavicle. So the patient will not be able to perform this action. Okay, now come to the deltoid. Now you see, deltoid is innervated by axillary nerve, and it is responsible for abduction from 15 to 100 degrees. Okay. Also, you see here, it is written medial rotation of the arm. Okay. It is responsible for medial rotation of the arm. Posterior fibers extend and laterally rotate the arm. So, now what you need to remember over here is the posterior fibers will be damaged more than the anterior fibers. Okay, the posterior fibers will be damaged more than the anterior fibers. Therefore, the patient cannot perform lateral rotation. The patient will unable to perform lateral rotation, and the hand will be medially rotated. Okay, so you need to remember, because deltoid's anterior fibers perform medial rotation and posterior fibers perform lateral rotation. Okay, so, but in the patient, we see the patient comes to us with a medially rotated hand. The patient comes to us in the hospital with a medially rotated hand. That means the posterior fibers are damaged more than the anterior ones. Also, come to supraspinatus and infraspinatus. You see, they both are innervated by suprascapular nerve, the nerve which is coming from the upper trunk. Okay, and what are their actions? Suprascapular nerve abducts the arm. Okay, 0 to 15 degrees abduction. That means the patient cannot initiate abduction. Okay, then the infraspinatus muscle's action is laterally rotation of the arm. So that means, again, when infraspinatus will be damaged, the lateral rotation will be compromised, and the patient will come to you with a medially rotated hand. Okay, clear? Now, also axillary nerve. When axillary nerve is damaged, the teres minor, there will be effect on the teres minor muscle, and teres minor muscle is also a lateral rotator. Again, the patient will come with the medial rotation of hand, because the nerve is damaged, the muscle is paralyzed, and lateral rotation cannot be happened. So, summing up this all thing, now you can also write in your notes lateral rotators of arm. Just write the heading lateral rotators of arm. Lateral rotators of arm, and write down number one infraspinatus. Write it down, people. Lateral rotators of arm, heading number one infraspinatus, number two teres minor, नंबर थ्री डेल्टॉइड, नंबर थ्री डेल्टॉइड एंड राइट डाउन इन द ब्रैकेट पोस्टीरियर फाइबर्स, पोस्टीरियर फाइबर्स, डेल्टॉइड पोस्टीरियर फाइबर्स. सो नाउ हियर यू हैव अ वेरी गुड कॉन्सेप्ट, अ वेरी गुड कॉन्सेप्ट दैट एक्सिलरी नर्व इज डैमेज्ड, डैमेज टू डेल्टॉइड, डैमेज टू टीरियस माइनर, नो लेटरल रोटेशन, ओनली द पेशेंट विल कम विद मीडियल रोटेशन. क्लियर? एक्सिलरी नर्व इज डैमेज्ड, डेल्टॉइड अबडक्शन इज लॉस्ट, सुप्रास्कैपुलर नर्व इज डैमेज्ड, सुप्रास्पाइनेटस अबडक्शन इज लॉस्ट. सो नो अबडक्शन, नो अबडक्शन फ्रॉम 0 to 100 degree, 100, राइट? बिकॉज दोनों का मसला है ना, दोनों का मसला है. तो 0 to 100 degree, नो अबडक्शन. द पेशेंट विल कम टू यू विद एन एडक्टेड हैंड, एडक्टेड हैंड. ओके, नाउ what was the next nerve, what was the another main nerve, musculocutaneous nerve, musculocutaneous nerve. So musculocutaneous was responsible for flexion, musculocutaneous was responsible for flexion. Okay, flexion of three muscles, here it is. Okay, now you see, जिसने भी lecture number 2 लिया है muscles पर, उसको ये सारा समझाया था. अब वी हैव एन एंटीरियर कंपार्टमेंट ऑफ आर्म, बीबीसी, थ्री मसल्स, फ्लेक्सर्स, एंड ऑल दीज थ्री मसल्स आर इनोवेटेड बाय मस्क्यूलोकुटेनियस नर्व. सो द डैमेज टू मस्क्यूलोकुटेनियस नर्व, द डैमेज टू दीज थ्री मसल्स, दैट मीन्स नो फ्लेक्शन. द पेशेंट विल कम विद एन एक्सटेंडेड हैंड, एक्सटेंडेड हैंड. सो गाइस, अगर किसी ने लेक्चर्स नहीं लिए तो प्लीज ले लें, इसमें बहुत सारी काम की बातें हैं और निमोनिक्स हैं. सो understand people, this is how you will learn and remember. Now come to the mechanism of action. So you see what will be seen, extended, adducted and medially rotated hand, okay, will be seen. So how, now come to the mechanism, how the patient undergoes this Erb-Dukin palsy, how the patient undergoes this Erb-Dukin palsy, how the patient undergoes this C5-C6 upper trunk injury, because of two mechanisms. The first is, you will see a scenario that a 28 year old man was painting a hoardings that are on the roadside, jis par ads lage hote hain, theek hai. The patient, a 28 year old man was painting a hoarding and suddenly he fell from the ladder to the ground on his right shoulder, on his right shoulder. So the patient fell on his shoulder. This is your key point to understand, fall on shoulder. Ye sare points bahut zaruri hote hain yaad rakhna. The reason is because these are the key words of your MCQs, these are the key words of your MCQs. Fall on shoulder is a key word, okay? Remember it with C5-C6 upper trunk injury. Then another is, you will see a case scenario that a G1P2 Gravidian para, forget about that, that is not your piece of cake for step 1, that is for step 2 people understanding what it is. I'm just telling you a case. G1P2 mother was having a normal vaginal delivery and excessive, and while the traction of baby, while the traction of head of the baby, the neck was excessively pulled, and the patient, and after the delivery, the baby was taken to pediatric ward with the chief complaint of shoulder dystocia. What is shoulder dystocia? Shoulder dystocia is drooping of shoulder joint. Let me show you in a picture. ओके दिस इज शोल्डर डिस्टोसिया. ओके शोल्डर डिस्टोसिया. शोल्डर डिस्टोसिया इज अ लाइफ थ्रेटनिंग एमरजेंसी. इट मस्ट बी रिकॉग्नाइज एंड ट्रीटेड क्विकली टू अवॉइड सिग्निफिकेंट मॉर्बिडिटी एंड इवन मॉर्टलिटी. शोल्डर डिस्टोसिया इज एनी सेफेलिक डिलीवरी. सेफेलिक मीन्स वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट हेड, दैट द हेड इज कमिंग फर्स्ट. दैट इज वी कॉल्ड सेफेलिक डिलीवरी. एंड द नॉर्मल पोजिशन ऑफ द बेबी इज ऑल्सो सेफेलिक. ओके where maneuvers other than gentle traction are required to deliver the baby after the head has delivered. It is a bony impaction, usually of the anterior shoulder of the baby, because anterior shoulder dystocia is common because posterior one niche hota hai, anterior upar hota hai. And we take out the baby in this way and the anterior shoulder is stuck inside the uterus of the mother. Okay, तो उसको थोड़ा pressure apply करते हैं तो bone impact हो जाती है, निकलती नहीं है, फिर उसकी वजह से प्रॉपरली जॉइंट्स बने नहीं होते हैं बच्चों के और फिर शोल्डर डिस्टोसिया हो जाता है. यूजुअली ऑफ द एंटीरियर शोल्डर ऑफ द बेबी ऑन द मैटरनल पेल्विस, यूजुअली द सिम्फिसिस. ठीक है, सिम्फिसिस प्यूबिस के पास. एंड अकर्स इन अप टू 1% ऑफ द डिलीवरीज. इट इज नॉट वेरी कॉमन बट वी सी एंटीरियर शोल्डर डिस्टोसिया. ओके I want to show you a see this picture. This is a trunk. Okay, these are the roots and this is the trunk. So you see, because of shoulder dystocia, these nerves are pulled. तो एक shoulder ऊपर होता है, एक shoulder नीचे होता है. ठीक है, समटाइम्स दी ब्लड सप्लाई इज ऑल्सो कॉम्प्रोमाइज बिकॉज मेजर एक्सिलरी आर्टरी इज पासिंग टू दिस हैंड. तो कभी कभी वो भी डैमेज हो जाती है. सो दिस इज साइनोसिस, ब्लूइश डिस्कलरेशन ऑफ हैंड. ओके सो दिस कैन ऑल्सो हैपन, ब्लूइश डिस्कलरेशन ऑफ हैंड. सो अर्ब्स पालसी में ऐसा भी मिलता है. ओके Let's not get into a lot of detail. Now you understand what is shoulder dystocia while delivery. Dystocia while delivery because of the excessive neck pulling. Excessive neck pulling. So this is all about the Erb-Dukin palsy. Now I'll show you a video so that you can understand this Erb-Dukin palsy. Okay. And for this kind of lectures on the brachial plexus injury, I will upload one injury, one video. Okay, so that it will be easier for everyone because most of the people are kind of complaining that the videos are too long and try to make them short. 1 hour, 30 minutes, koi sunta nahi hai, but I am still very glad that most of the people are hearing and listening my videos. They are watching it entirely, 1 hour, 30 minutes, and it is good. Actually, because my success is that I am investing my time in explaining you people all this stuff and making these PDFs and explaining you all this stuff. So if it is kind of benefiting you, it is like beneficial for you. You are investing your time and you are putting in efforts to hear this all and grab this, and that is what my intention have been. Okay, so but now I'll try to make the short videos also. If kindly give me a response regarding it, what you people want. Because majority is authority. What majority will say, I will do that thing. Okay, now I'll show you a video on it and then I'll end this lecture. So you see, I have recorded this video. The credits goes to my sister. And let me play it.
Hi, I'm going to ह्यूमन मॉडल के ऊपर दिखा रही हूँ अर्बिकेट पॉलिसी, ठीक है। ये जिस पोजीशन में ये हाथ आपको नजर आ रहा है, इस पोजीशन को हम कहते हैं नॉर्मल एनाटॉमिकल पोजीशन। दूसरा हाथ भी इसी पोजीशन में होगा, मैं सिर्फ एक ही हाथ से समझा रही हूँ, ठीक है। तो ये इसको कहते हैं एनाटॉमिकल पोजीशन। आपका फेस फॉरवर्ड होता है और आपके पाम्स जो होते हैं वो फॉरवर्ड मूव होते हैं, ठीक है। अब पहले मैं आपको नॉर्मल मूवमेंट्स बताऊंगी और फिर ये बताऊंगी कि अर्बिकेट पॉलिसी मूवमेंट्स किस तरह होती है, ठीक है। ये एल्बो जॉइंट जो है इस टाइम एक्सटेंडेड, क्योंकि ये जो एंगल है क्यूबॉइडल फोसा का जो एंगल है ये वाइड है। जब मैं कहूंगी कि इस एंगल को नैरो कीजिए तो इसको कहते हैं फ्लेक्स पोजीशन। एक्सटेंड फ्लेक्स, एक्सटेंड फ्लेक्स, ठीक है। ओके, अब ये तो हो गई एल्बो की मूवमेंट। जब हम फोर आर्म के मूवमेंट की बात करते हैं, ये आर्म है ये फोर आर्म है, जब हम फोर आर्म के मूवमेंट की बात करते हैं तो ये जो आपको इस तरह नजर आ रहा है इसमें क्या है कि रेडियस और अल्ना, अल्ना मीडियल होती है, रेडियस लेटरल होती है। रेडियस और अल्ना दोनों बोन्स एक दूसरे के पैरेलल, पैरेलल बोन्स, ठीक है। जब मैं कहूंगी ये है प्रोनेटेड, दिस इज प्रोनेटेड हैंड जिसमें आपको क्यूबॉइडल फोसा नजर आ रहा है। नॉर्मल एनाटॉमिकल पोजीशन के अंदर फोर आर्म प्रोनेटेड होता है। जब मैं कहूंगी इसको सुपिनेट कीजिए तो ये इस तरीके से हो जाए। अब ये सुपिनेटेड है, इसमें क्या है कि रेडियस और अल्ना दोनों एक दूसरे के ऊपर ऐसे ओवरलैप कर जाएंगे, ठीक है। प्रोनेटेड सुपिनेटेड, प्रोनेटेड सुपिनेटेड, क्लियर। अब मैं बताऊंगी आपको, ये हो गई फोर आर्म की मूवमेंट, फ्लेक्सन एक्सटेंशन हो गई, एल्बो जॉइंट की मूवमेंट। अब आपके पास आ गया आर्म की मूवमेंट। आर्म की जो मूवमेंट है, आर्म के मूवमेंट में आपके पास दो मूवमेंट होंगी, एक होगी एडक्शन अबडक्शन, ठीक है। तो ये हाथ नॉर्मल एनाटॉमिकल पोजीशन के अंदर जो आपकी बॉडी से लगा हुआ है तो ये है एडक्शन, ADD से मैंने याद कराया था, ये है एडक्शन। लेकिन जब इस हैंड को हम बॉडी से अवे लेके जाएंगे, ठीक है, तो ये हो गया एबडक्शन। अब एबडक्शन में भी डिफरेंट एंगल्स होते हैं। मैंने आपको बताया था 0 से 15 डिग्री, 15 से 90 डिग्री एंड 90 से अबव द हेड जब हाथ चला जाए, ठीक है। तो तीन डिफरेंट मसल्स हैं, उनकी तीन डिफरेंट नर्व्स हैं जो ये मूवमेंट्स करवा रही हैं। जब हम 0 से 15 जाते हैं तो सुप्रा स्पाइनेटस, जब हम 0 से 15 के बाद 15 से 90 जाते हैं तो डेल्टॉइड मसल, और जब हम डेल्टॉइड से अबव चले जाते हैं तो ट्रैपीजियस मसल, ठीक है। तो एडक्शन एबडक्शन, एडक्शन एबडक्शन, ये भी हो गई आर्म की मूवमेंट। अब हम बात करेंगे फोर आर्म की मूवमेंट, सॉरी आर्म की दूसरी मूवमेंट की। आर्म की दूसरी मूवमेंट क्या है? अब ये हैंड इस वक्त क्या है, नॉर्मल एनाटॉमिकल पोजीशन में। मैं इस फोर आर्म को प्रोनेट ही रखूंगी, इसको सुपिनेट नहीं करूंगी, ये प्रोनेट होगा। हाथ मूव कहां से होगा? यहां से मूव होगा। हाथ को यहां से मूव कराना है, मीडियल रोटेशन करानी है, यानी कि बॉडी की तरफ ऐसे पीछे चला जाएगा। ये चीज किसी ने मूव नहीं कराई, ये अपनी जगह वैसी की वैसी है, सिर्फ इसमें मूवमेंट है। ये क्या है? मीडियल रोटेशन। अब लेटरल रोटेशन तो बाहर की तरफ मूव हो गया, ये हो गया लेटरल रोटेशन। मीडियल रोटेशन, लेटरल रोटेशन, मीडियल रोटेशन, लेटरल रोटेशन, ठीक है। तो ये हो गया मीडियल लेटरल रोटेशन। ये समझ में आ गया नॉर्मल मूवमेंट्स। अब मैं आपको बताती हूँ अर्थ टुकिंग पॉलिसी में क्या होता है। अर्थ टुकिंग पॉलिसी में क्या होगा कि हमारे पास C5 C6 जो ब्रेकियल प्लेक्सस की अपर ट्रंक है उसकी इंजरी है अर्थ टुकिंग पॉलिसी, ठीक है। तो वहां से जितनी नर्व्स निकल रही हैं वो सब डैमेज होंगी, वो नर्व्स डैमेज होंगी तो उनके मसल्स पैरालाइज होंगे, उनके मसल्स पैरालाइज होंगे तो उनका नॉर्मल फंक्शन लॉस हो जाएगा, ठीक है। तो अब जो पेशेंट अर्थ टुकिंग पॉलिसी के साथ हॉस्पिटल में आएगा उसे आप एक नजर देखकर अंदाजा लगा लोगे, ओ माय गॉड इसको अर्थ टुकिंग पॉलिसी। कैसे, कौन कौन से मूवमेंट्स होंगी? आपने सिर्फ तीन मूवमेंट्स याद रखनी है, ठीक है, तीन मूवमेंट्स आपने याद रखनी है। अच्छा, नॉर्मल एनाटॉमिकल पोजिशन में खड़े होना, ठीक है। अब मैं आपको जैसे जैसे बताऊंगी आपने अपना हैंड वैसे मूव कराना, ठीक है। पहली चीज ये आपने याद रखनी है कि अर्थ टुकिंग पॉलिसी के अंदर एक्सटेंशन होगी एल्बो जॉइंट की, तो ये एक्सटेंडेड ही है, ठीक है, ये एक्सटेंडेड है, इसको नहीं छेड़ना, ये एक्सटेंडेड है, ठीक है। और प्रोनेटेड, प्रोनेटेड होगा तो ये प्रोनेटेड भी है, इसको भी नहीं छेड़ना। एक्सटेंडेड, प्रोनेटेड और तीसरी चीज होगी मीडियल रोटेशन। तो आपने आर्म को मीडियली इन्होंने रोटेट कर दिया। अब आप ये देख रहे हैं नीचे से ये हाथ देख रहे हैं, ये बिल्कुल ऐसे जैसे पैसे दो भाई वैसे दो, जैसे पुलिस मैन टिप लेता है या वोल्डर टिप लेता है तो, और मैं इनको टिप दे दूं, तो ये इस तरीके की पोजिशन होगी मरीज की जब वो आएगा हॉस्पिटल के अंदर। इसका नाम पढ़ लिया अर्बुकिन पॉलिसी, अदरवाइज इसका दूसरा नाम है इस हैंड की इस पोजीशन की वजह से पुलिस नाइन टिप डिफॉर्मिटी या पोल्टर टिप डिफॉर्मिटी। ठीक हो गया, अब बाकी की हम नोट्स के ऊपर और पिक्चर्स के ऊपर करते हैं। थैंक यू सो मच।
ओके पीपल, सो दिस वॉज एन एक्सप्लेनेशन। अच्छा, मैं यहाँ पर एक पॉइंट ऐड कर दूँ, जो मैंने प्रोनेशन का वर्ड का जिक्र किया है वो इसलिए किया है क्योंकि मैंने आपको पहले बताया था कि दो मसल्स होते हैं जो प्रोनेशन के लिए रिस्पॉन्सिबल होते हैं। एक तो मेजर मसल है प्रोनेटर टीरीज, ठीक है, और उसको नर्व कौन सी सप्लाई करती है, मीडियन नर्व। तो मीडियन नर्व की तो यहाँ पर कोई मसला मसाइल नहीं हो रहे ना, तो प्रोनेशन तो अपनी जगह इंटैक्ट है, ठीक है। अच्छा, दूसरा जो है वो कौन सा है, बाइसेप ब्रेकाई। लेकिन बाइसेप ब्रेकाई ना सेकेंडरी मसल है। अगर कोई ये समझ रहा है कि प्रोनेशन इफेक्ट होगी और सुपीनेशन हो जाएगी, तो ऐसा नहीं होगा। पहला मसल जो प्रोनेशन कराता है वो प्रोनेटर टीरीज है, ठीक है। दूसरा मसल जो कराता है वो बाइसेप ब्रेकाई है। तो जब मसला मीडियन नर्व का होगा और ये प्रोनेटर्स मसल इफेक्ट होंगे, तो फिर जो अगला मसल उसको ओवरटेक करता है वो बाइसेप होता है। तो अभी मेन मसल में मसला नहीं है प्रोनेशन वाले, तो इसलिए प्रोनेशन इंटैक्ट रहेगी, ठीक है। मसले कहां पर आ रहे हैं, मसले आ रहे हैं फ्लेक्जर नहीं हो सकती तो एक्सटेंडेड हैंड होगा, एबडक्शन नहीं हो सकती तो एडक्टेड हैंड होगा, और लेटरल रोटेशन नहीं हो सकती तो मीडियल रोटेशन होगी। और मैंने आपको मसल्स ही बता दिए और उन मसल्स की नर्व्स भी बता दी और आपको पूरा एक कोरिलेशन बता दिया। अगर किसी को अभी भी नहीं समझ में आया तो प्लीज मुझे नीचे मैसेज करके बोलेगा, मैं इसको और सिंपलर वे में समझाने की कोशिश करूंगी इन दी नेक्स्ट वीडियो, ठीक है। अच्छा, अब इसके बाद नेक्स्ट हम नेक्स्ट वीडियो मैं बनाऊंगी थोरेसिक आउटलेट सिंड्रोम पर, ठीक है, जो कि आपके पास लोअर ट्रंक इंजरी है C8 और T1, ठीक है, इसके ऊपर मैं नेक्स्ट वीडियो बनाऊंगी। तो अब मैं इस तरह छोटी छोटी वीडियोज बनाकर डाल रही हूँ, हमारे पास 5 हैं ये, तो इंशाल्लाह ताला आई विल ट्राई माई बेस्ट टू अपलोड दिस पिक्चर एट टुडे नाइट और टुमारो अर्ली मॉर्निंग, ओके, लाइक बाय दिस टाइम, ओके पीपल। सो टेक केयर टिल देन, लर्न दिस, अंडरस्टैंड दिस, और कोई मसला हो तो डू आस्क मी। अल्लाह हाफिज़।